stabbing, burning, sensitivity, electric shocks. These are some of the terrible symptoms of nerve pain resulting from various forms of injury to the nervous system. In this video, we're going to review some of the most common treatments of neuropathic pain. Normally with nociceptive pain, a normal nervous system relays signs of injury to the brain, where it's interpreted as pain. But in neuropathic pain, there is no specific injury, but an abnormal nervous system due to injury is kind of confused, so it's inappropriately relaying signals of pain to the brain. And this can occur with any injury to the nervous system. For instance, the peripheral nerves, as in diabetic neuropathy, the spinal cord, as in multiple sclerosis, the nerve root, as in a herniated disc, or the brain, as in a stroke. Now, I would give you fair warning that you really should talk to your provider about treating this because it can be extremely dangerous to treat the symptoms and not treat the underlying cause. So perhaps the most important thing is to try to treat the underlying cause. For instance, managing diabetes in someone with diabetic neuropathy or supplementing B12 in someone with B12-related spinal cord injury. However, in some cases, it's not possible to fully alleviate the pain, and some people need other treatments. And some of the most common treatments would be alternative treatments that don't involve pharmaceuticals, we'll talk about. Some dietary supplements have evidence in nerve pain. We'll talk about various medications, along with topical medications that only have a local effect, and a few psychological treatments as well. Now, a lot of these non-pharmacologic treatments, it's very unclear how they work, but there is evidence that they are effective. There are actually two types of sensory nervous systems within the body. One is the epicritic sensory nervous system, which senses things like fine touch and vibration. The other is the protopathic sensory nervous system, which senses temperature and pain. And it turns out, for unclear reasons, known as the gated theory of pain, that stimulating the epicritic sensory nervous system may temporarily suppress the protopathic nervous system. And that's sort of how some of these treatments are thought to work. And some examples would be acupuncture. There's transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation, which are devices that provide current to the skin and suppress pain. There's actually a permanent implantable spinal cord stimulator that stimulates the back of the spinal cord, the dorsal column, and this is usually when other treatments have been unsuccessful. There's most evidence for post-laminectomy syndrome, which is failed back surgery, and complex regional pain syndrome. And there are also less invasive peripheral nerve stimulators that kind of do the same thing. So this is a man receiving acupuncture. This is someone using a TENS unit, a transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation units. And these range from very cheap units costing $10 to $15 to some costing thousands of dollars. But they're relatively safe and they can be effective in some people. This is a fluoroscopic image of someone who has a spinal cord stimulator, and you can see the device to the right. And this is a peripheral nerve stimulator, a sural nerve stimulator that is, of course, much less invasive. Now, what about dietary supplements? The most common supplements used are ALA, alpha-lipoic acid, and the doses range from 200 milligrams a day to 600 or even 1200 milligrams twice daily. And the other is benfotiamine, usually 150 milligrams a day. Benfotiamine is a lipid-soluble form of thiamine that's thought to have better penetration into the nervous system, and it was originally developed to treat Wernicke's encephalopathy, a rare complication of vitamin B1 deficiency, but it's been used to treat neuropathic pain. Now, both of these really only have evidence in diabetic peripheral neuropathy, but as you'll see with a lot of these treatments, a treatment that's been used for nerve pain is usually used for almost all forms of nerve pain. So these are used for other forms of nerve pain as well. Now, we'll talk about some of the medications. Perhaps the most common medication used is gabapentin or Neurontin. Now, we don't know how a lot of these medications work, but gabapentin has an effect on voltage-gated sodium channels, which are involved in nerve pain transmission. So we think that most of these medications either work through these sodium channels or other neurotransmitters or calcium channels, or in some cases, NMDA receptors and other things. So they affect nerve pain transmission in some way. Now, the doses of gabapentin vary greatly. Low doses from 100 milligrams up to 1800 milligrams three times daily. And some people really do require these higher doses to see any benefits. So if low doses aren't working, but there are no side effects, a typical recommendation would be to just increase the dose. That being said, there can be side effects, especially at higher doses. The most common things would be pedal edema or swelling in the ankles. They can be sedating. Rarely people can have serious allergies, for instance, angioedema, swelling of the lips and tongue that can be quite dangerous and require stopping the medications. It should also be noted that if you're taking a higher dose and you suddenly stop, rarely people can have seizures, so it's recommended to go down on the dose slowly. This is just an example of a Cochrane evidence-based review of gabapentin in postherpetic neuralgia, which is chronic pain after shingles. And you can see on the right-hand side the various studies that have been done. Some were more positive than others, but on the average, they all clearly showed a benefit versus placebo. More to the right means more benefit versus placebo. Now, another class of medications that's been used is tricyclic antidepressants. The most common would be nortriptyline, Pamelor, or amitriptyline. Another is disipramine. For nortriptyline and amitriptyline, typically we give a small dose, 10 milligrams, and we advise people to increase by one tablet every week up to a maximum of 50 milligrams, although some people use higher doses such as 75 milligrams. And generally, you would stop at the lowest effective dose. For instance, you would take 10 milligrams at night for 1 week, and then 20 milligrams at night for 1 week, and then 30 milligrams at night, and if that was effective, you wouldn't go up to the higher dose. The most common side effect is that it's sedating, but a lot of people like that because it's taken at night and it helps them sleep. It can also cause dry mouth and constipation, but usually mild, not severe enough to warrant stopping the medication. It should also be noted that these drugs, they used to be used as antidepressants, but they're not so commonly used anymore because they can be quite dangerous, especially with overdose. So before starting these medications, we recommend checking an EKG or electrocardiogram. And the reason is that some people have an abnormality called a prolonged QT interval. QTC stands for QT corrected. And basically, if it's too long, it can be very dangerous to start these medications because it can lead to a serious cardiac arrhythmia. And as I said, these medications can be very dangerous in overdose. Another class that's used is SNRIs, or serotonin norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors. Examples include Effexor, venlafaxine, and Cymbalta, duloxetine, and you can see the doses there. Usually they're very well tolerated at lower doses. At higher doses, some people get drowsiness, nausea, dizziness, dry mouth, and rarely people have allergies to these medications. Some other examples include Lyrica or pregabalin, which is very similar to gabapentin I mentioned earlier. Clonidine is a medication usually used to treat high blood pressure, and there's a transdermal formulation that's given just once per 24 hours. The side effects are that it can be sedating and cause low blood pressure. Topamax or topiramate is usually used to treat seizures, or it's FDA approved to treat migraines as well, and doses can go up to 200 milligrams twice daily. The most common side effect is probably tingling of the skin, although if you drink a lot of water, it often reduces this sensation. Kidney stones is also a known side effect, so it's recommended to drink a lot of water. And some people, especially at higher doses, complain of some kind of cognitive changes and poor focus and poor memory, and so some people call this drug Dopamax instead of Topamax. I should also note that it can potentially cause birth defects such as cleft palate. Another drug that's been used is lamotrigine or Lamictal, which is normally approved to treat bipolar disorder and seizures. However, it has been used to treat neuropathic pain because it has some effect on those voltage-gated sodium channels. One thing to note about Lamictal is that it has to be increased very slowly because some people can have a severe rash with it known as Stevens-Johnson syndrome. The drug mexiletine is normally a drug used to treat cardiac arrhythmias, but this drug itself can sometimes cause cardiac arrhythmias and is probably one of the more dangerous drugs on this list and is only usually used if other treatments are ineffective. Now, I should also note there are a few treatments that are most commonly used for specific pain syndromes. One example would be carbamazepine and oxcarbazepine, Tegretol and Trileptal, respectively, which are used to treat trigeminal neuralgia, which is sort of a brief electric shock of the face. And it can occur with multiple sclerosis or other conditions or on its own. It should be noted that these drugs can cause, in some cases, a lowering of the white blood cells and low sodium, so it's actually recommended to do some blood tests after starting it. Also, people who are of Han Chinese descent are more likely to be allergic to this medication, and they can potentially have a severe allergy, again known as Stevens-Johnson syndrome. And it turns out people with the genetic polymorphism HLA-B1502, which can actually be tested by a simple blood test, are more likely to have this allergy. Ketamine, which is an NMDA or glutamate receptor antagonist, can be used for nerve pain, although it causes a lot of psychiatric and cardiac side effects, so it's mostly used for the specific condition called complex regional pain syndrome. I should also note that cannabinoids, as in marijuana, and opioids have been used. The problem with opioids is they can cause a lot of side effects and tolerance and dependence, and so they're not that commonly used for neuropathic pain. This is an example of a study on sativex, which is synthetic marijuana in multiple sclerosis. Now, this is a study with only 10 patients, open label, no control group, so take it with a grain of salt, but they did report a decrease in pain based on the visual analog pain scale after the treatment. There are also some topical treatments, such as lidocaine, which is the drug that's normally used by injection when you have a laceration sewed up in the emergency department. There's also a topical formulation of that. Capsaicin is from canine peppers and temporarily numbs the skin. I have the best results with mixtures, often made in a compounding pharmacy. And you can see a screenshot of something I use commonly, which is clonidine, gabapentin, ketamine, lidocaine. And you can see the doses there in a topical gel. I've had the best success with that agent, personally. There are also some psychological techniques. Now, I hope this isn't taken in the wrong way, saying that it's all in your head and you should learn to ignore your pain, but sometimes, in conjunction with other treatments, things like meditation and therapy, in particular cognitive behavioral therapy and acceptance and commitment therapy, can help to reduce pain, especially in conjunction with other treatments. Do you have nerve pain? Have you had success or failure with any of the treatments? Please post in the comments below, and if you have any further questions or requests for future videos, please post in the comments below.